This is probably my favorite question because we've never told this story before publicly. Do you plan to have kids someday? All right, this is a touchy subject.
This is a divisive one.
If you guys missed our last video, we drove up to the Texas Panhandle to go camping and hiking for a couple weekends, starting with Caprock Canyon State Park. And before we left, we asked you guys for some questions for us to answer in a Q&A vlog, and boy, did you guys deliver.
We've done a couple of Q&As before, one about travel and one about van life, so go check those out if you haven't seen them, as they answer a lot of the FAQs we get, but this time we're gonna try to answer a wide variety of questions, and we have a lot of questions, so it's probably gonna be a really long video, especially because we like to get chatty and ramble, so we'll put all the questions and the timestamps in the description below in case you guys are short on time. All right, question number one. We're starting with the mushy romance stuff, you guys. How did you meet each other and how did you know each other was the one?
So we met on Catherine's first day of work at a burger place we both worked at called Mighty Fine in Austin. We were both in college. We became friends for about a year. Then we dated for a few years before we got married on October 12th, 2014.
And how did we know each other was the one? That's a hard question.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just one of those things where it's like an indescribable, you just kind of, when you know, but I guess since we need to provide an answer, we became friends first. We were like best friends and we just, you know, balance each other out well, our personalities, and we want the same things in life. We support each other. We help each other grow. We have fun together. I don't know. I mean,
it just felt great and felt perfect, and had a great time with each other all the time. So,
and 6 years later, we're living in a van 24/7 with each other and absolutely loving
going
it.
Strong.
So, I think, well, we know we made the right choice.
Who is older out of the two of you? Easy question. I'm 33. Pretty sure you're 28, right?
At a certain age, you
always forget.
At a certain age, you kind of have to do the math every time you're asked that question. But yes, I'm 28, almost 28 and a half. Why did you choose Austin as your home base? So before we moved into the van, we lived in Seattle for 3 years, but before that we lived in Austin. So my parents live in Austin, and when you're traveling and you're nomadic, you still need a legal address for like your driver's license, insurance, bills, all the fun adult things. So we use my parents' address as our legal address. That way we can get mail. And then also whenever we're not traveling in the van, it's kind of our home base because it's a free place to stay. They have room for the van, room for us, tools to work on the van, and Kona just loves it there. So that's kind of how it became our home base for now.
What do you do for work? So I teach English online to students in China on this website called VipKid. And then I also do some other things on our travel business.
And then I work full-time as a digital marketer for a fully remote tech company. They were remote before COVID, so I've been remote for a couple years now. And then I also work full-time on our travel business. And just to explain the travel business, we have our website, YouTube, which both make us money. We also have affiliate income, partnerships, some amazing folks supporting our work on Patreon, and a couple other different revenue streams. It's not enough to fully support us at the moment, but it's growing, and hopefully one day we can make that a reality, because to be honest, juggling working multiple jobs,
it's a lot.
It's not sustainable in the long term for like mental health and just like having a work-life balance. So hopefully one day, because we'd love to be able to fully create content 24/7, make more videos, write more guides, and travel more.
What does your schedule look like balancing day jobs, blogging, and filming? So I get up usually at 4 a.m. to start teaching on VipKid. Catherine sometimes gets up with me. Sometimes she doesn't. She sleeps on the other side of the bench for a couple more hours. But by 6 a.m., she's up and working. So we're working on our day jobs from 6 to 3 p.m. And in between there, we take a break to work out. I cook breakfast and lunch. And I finish up my VipKid stuff, write blog posts, research for future videos. By the time 3 p.m. rolls around, we take Kona on a walk for about an hour or so. And then from 3:30 or 4 until bedtime, we're working on our A+K stuff, editing videos, writing guides, things like that. So.
And eating,
and
the most important part.
We have dinner in there too.
So that's kind of what our weekdays look like. Our weekends are a lot different because we pretty much only film on the weekends. We're actually filming this on a weekday, but it's harder with work and stuff to film on weekdays unless we take a day off work.
Yeah.
So we film pretty much all day on the weekend, sometimes both days, sometimes just one day. And then when we're done filming, we usually just start editing, cranking out as much work as possible. So our weekends are a lot different. One thing we do want to like just make clear, because we feel like this lifestyle can look so glamorous on, you know, Instagram and videos.
It's always the highlight.
Yeah, and I mean, we try to be as real as possible, but we're obviously not going to just make videos of us sitting around working all day. No one would want to watch that. But we work a lot more now than we have ever worked before. I mean, a lot of hours from as soon as we wake up to go to bed. So it's a lot of hard work to make this lifestyle happen, but it's totally worth it.
For sure.
To be able to, you know, be wherever you want to be on the weekends and go explore. If you weren't traveling full time, what would your dream job be? To be honest, this is my dream job, the whole A plus K traveling stuff, just being able to help people plan their own adventures, sharing our adventures, writing travel guides. That's as cheesy as it sounds, it's like my passion and like what I feel like I was made to do. So it's my dream job.
I've got two dream jobs. Right now, currently, I'm working my dream job, do fun stuff, do crazy adventures all the time, and work with my best friend. But my other dream job is actually what I left to go full-time traveling, is a golf coach. That's like my dream job, for as like a working for someone else dream job. It was the best, but to appease that, maybe I'll do that again one day, but to appease that for now, maybe I'll just try to play more golf on the road.
If you could, this is a fun one.
Yeah.
If you could only say a single unique word for the rest of your life, what would it be? Want to give Connor a big shout out, because yeah, he sent us a bunch of like crazy questions and they're awesome.
This is a good one though.
He did say we can change the inflection or volume of this word.
So mine, I would go with food. I went with a word that would keep me alive as long as possible. So I would just say food all the time. Food! Food.
Food?
Food? Food.
Mine's kind of similar. I went with queso because it's like a multifunctional word. One, I could just constantly ask people for queso and I'd be a very happy woman, but I could also be like, queso? Or like, queso. So there's different ways you could work the queso word. That's a hard question though.
Yeah.
Kona, who's in the van right now, her answer is ball, because
100%.
That's literally all she thinks about is ball.
Mm-hmm.
And you say ball and she just perks up, so that's her word.
How did you start vlogging and were you nervous at first?
So when we started vlogging, we already had our website with travel guides as well as like trip recaps and stuff like that. And during that time, we started watching travel vlogs on YouTube and just really, really enjoyed watching them. Thought that might be kind of fun to do in addition to our more like detailed travel guides. So we started a YouTube channel.
We were very nervous at first. And to be honest, we still get very nervous and anxious when we're filming. Sometimes I always say, if I would have asked myself 2 to 3 years ago if I was going to be on YouTube or filming myself all the time, I probably would have cried. It was all my idea, and I don't know what led, I guess what she said is what led us to do it, but I kind of surprise myself sometimes.
It is fun, but it's still nerve-wracking, yeah, a lot.
Which one of you edits your vlogs? So Catherine edits all the footage. She puts it in the right order, how the story we want to tell, and then I'll come in and I'll add music. And what I've started to do, I'm starting to learn animation and some other graphics to add a little pizzazz to our videos.
All right, this is a big question. I think we answered it on our last Q&A, but it comes up often, so we're answering it again. Do you plan to have kids someday? Answer is probably. We're not 100% sure. We're in zero rush. We've been married 6 years and are just loving life with us and Kona. So right now, we're just in no rush to have kids. But if we do have kids, we really want to make sure that we travel a lot with them. We want them to see different cultures, see the world, and just, you know, be outside. So we'd like to find a way to balance our lifestyle now with kids if we do have
them. Yeah, I mean, traveling for us has opened our minds to so many things, so we would love to share that with the kids that we may or may not have one day.
Where does Kona stay when she's not allowed somewhere? So this is probably our most asked question ever. We covered it in our last Q&A, and we also wrote a really detailed blog post on it, so go check that out because we cover it in a lot more detail. But the quick answer is she's either in the van, in an Airbnb, or with a sitter, and the answer depends on the temperature and like how long we're gonna leave her, just to make sure she's always safe.
This is a fun one. Who is the DJ on the road? What type of music or podcast do you listen to? So the DJ is this guy.
DJ Adam.
Yeah, so
wookie.
Our music interests are kind of all over the map. We go from Post Malone, Bastille, One Republic, Coldplay, Khalid, Kendrick Lamar, Arizona. I like a lot of Texas country. I've been getting into blues music lately. Not sure where that's coming from. So we listen to a lot of music, but then we also listen to a lot of podcasts. Our favorite podcast, one of our favorite podcasts, is Extra Pack of Peanuts. It's a travel podcast, and our friend Dan has asked us before if we would ever start a podcast, and answer for now is no, just because we just don't have the time or resources to do it. But if we ever did, we would like to style it the way they do. They do these destination diaries that covers kind of how we do our guides. So we do it in something similar like that. But I also listen to a lot of podcasts in the car and also on my own. Stuff about history, golf, and barbecue. And we'll link to some of them in the description below that I like to listen to.
What is your favorite Starbucks drink? So we try to go visit local coffee shops whenever we can, but sometimes you just need something quick and easy and reliable, and you go to Starbucks. So our go-to drink at Starbucks is a blonde Americano with cream. Our friend told us that the blonde roast just tastes so much better, and they're right. It tastes so much better. So try it with the blonde roast next time.
But when fall rolls around, don't you worry. We hit up those PSLs. What are the top foods you have tried on your travels?
So y'all know we love to eat, This was very hard. So we split it up to U.S. and abroad. So U.S., we love the tacos from Tacos El Gordo. They're in San Diego and Las Vegas. We also love Lewis Barbecue in Charleston.
So hungry.
Such a good barbecue. And then we also loved Clementine's ice cream in St. Louis. That place almost made me cry. It was so good.
Yeah. For our abroad options, we're going to go with the gelato from La Romana in Rome. Place was amazing. We hadn't seen this in any other place. They put chocolate on the bottom of your cone, just a little chocolate on the bottom, and just takes it to the next level. And whipped cream on top. And if your whipped cream falls off, they'll give you free whipped cream to top it.
You're messy like me, and you drop things.
So yeah, we go with that place. We also love tacos from El Vilcito in Mexico City. That place is just super cool and super delicious. What else? So we also can't stop talking about Indian food at Dishoom in the UK. We get there twice, once in London
and once in Edinburgh.
It was amazing. We got a giant table spread of food. It was just amazing. And then our favorite sandwich ever, Al Antico in Florence, Italy. We bought how many?
I think we bought eight in our 2 days there.
I was
going to
go with six, but okay, we bought eight.
We bought so many sandwiches.
And they're big.
They're so good. What is your favorite ice cream flavor? You guys know we also love our ice cream. So I love anything peanut butter or caramelly and lots of chunks. We love like cake, cookie, just anything chunky in ice cream to give it some extra crunch and texture.
Same for me. But I also like the fruity one. So if there's like a apple pie one or apple crumble or
brambleberry crisp,
brambleberry crisp, strawberry balsamic, any kind of crazy spin on a fruit one, I'm going with that one too.
Yeah, you get ice cream.
That was
good. Just kidding. We're not eating ice cream right now. We wish.
Yeah.
How much food does your fridge hold, and do you have to go to the grocery store every couple days, or do you eat out often? So our fridge is obviously pretty small. It fits so much food. We can easily fit a week's worth of food in there. And just to give you guys a better idea of how we eat, we mostly eat refrigerated foods like meat and veggies, things that have to stay cold. For this trip, we're gone for 9 days. We brought all of our own food with us, so we don't have to go to grocery stores or interact with anyone, and we fit it just fine. We cook during the week, every single day, every meal, because one, we're trying to be healthier and save money, and then we try to only eat out on the weekends when we're filming videos.
What is your favorite non-cooked meal while traveling if you do not have a stove? So some of our easy things we go with is lunch or deli meat, hummus wrap. So we'll put some lunch meat with hummus and wrap it in a tortilla or in a romaine lettuce shell. We like the Gone Mary's crackers and veggies, dip that in the hummus. Just easy stuff you can grab. But one of our favorite things is a salad called the Southwest Salad from Trader Joe's, which we're actually about to make right now. As we mentioned, we love the Southwestern chopped salad. Delicious on its own. We love to pair it with their already cooked pork carnitas. So it's just kind of like a block of meat like this. You just cut it up, we cube it up, throw it in the pan, get a little crisp on it, get the juices flowing, and mix it all together, and it is so good.
All right, as we cook our dinner, we have a few more questions to answer. Scratch that, it's a lot more than a few. How many US states have you been to?
We've been to 32, we have all of New England left, some of the Midwest, and Alaska.
Do you plan to do international travel once COVID is over?
Absolutely. Our main goal, or what we would love to do, is do 1 month abroad and 3 months in the van, rinse and repeat. We have Kona. We don't want to leave her too long. Otherwise, we would go abroad for longer.
What are your top places that you want to travel in 2021? So we've basically given up hope to go abroad this year. We're just gonna stick to the US, but our big goals in the US are to finish the Utah National Parks. We've been to Zion and Bryce. We'd love to go back to them. We wanna do a bunch of hiking in Colorado. We wanna go backpacking in the Wind River Range in Wyoming. It looks so gorgeous. We wanna go to the Great Lakes states, preferably in the late summer, and then we'd like to do New England in the fall. We're hopeful that we can do all of it, but it depends on when we leave Texas and a few other factors, so even if we do 50%, we'll be happy. What are the top places you want to visit when COVID is over and why?
This is a very long list, but if we had to answer, we narrowed it down to three major places. So for me, I was going to go with Southeast Asia. So I want to experience all those countries, Cambodia, Vietnam, the Philippines, Thailand, all those. So just see the scenery, experience the street food, the culture, the people. Just it'll be outside of our comfort zone and be fun to experience. So I really want to go there. Go check out Oceania, go to Australia. Go road trip and camp all over New Zealand, hike, and then throw in a little bit of Tasmania. It would just be amazing.
And I want to go to the same places as him, but to add a third, we also really want to visit South America. We were supposed to go to Peru last June, but that obviously did not happen. So we'd love to do that Peru trip we had planned, plus add on a couple other countries. Same thing, the culture, the people, you know, experiencing a different language, mm-hmm. different foods, different scenery. That's just like our dream trip when we can combine all of that in one. So we'll see where we end up going. It'll depend on when we can go, flight deals, all of that. We wouldn't complain about anywhere at this point. Almost anywhere. If money was no object, what would be your dream destination?
So I would love to do all the big major hikes like in France, Spain, Switzerland. It's just absolutely gorgeous. I know those are probably pricey or can be. And another one though would be do like a month long or longer trip around Scotland, playing all the golf courses, all the Lynx Land courses. That would be just amazing.
Patagonia is probably number one on my bucket list, just doing a bunch of treks around there. I'd also love to do an African safari, but a luxury one, especially if money was no object. And then if money was really no object, I've always thought it'd be fun to stay in a hut over the water in Tahiti. I was recently looking into Tahiti just to dream about, and there's some cool looking hikes there. We could snorkel, we could wake up to ocean views. I just think that would be amazing. Kona, what would be your dream destination if money was no object?
I mean, just a big open field, maybe with some rabbits, some squirrels, and I mean, if you threw some balls in there, my head would just explode.
Kona, do you like to play ball?
Oh, yeah. Do you have a least favorite place or somewhere you would not return to? So there's not any place that we've had a bad experience or that we wouldn't return to, but during the week, when we're in between the weekend going to places that we love to go to, we're kind of stuck in kind of small towns that are just kind of convenient. There's cell service, we can do our laundry, go to the grocery store, there's a parking lot we can sleep in. So we wouldn't necessarily go back to those places, but we do love the main areas and the kind of the reason why we were in that area anyways.
Yeah, they're kind of just like really random places that we find ourselves like sleeping at and going to the grocery store or just working from parking lots. So they're not really destination type places. Yeah. So we're not like itching to get back there. This is probably my favorite question because we've never told this story before publicly. What was your worst, craziest, most difficult travel experience? So we've had good luck with traveling. We've had like small things go wrong, but nothing major. However, in Mexico City, something unpleasant happened to us. And we want to start this by saying we loved Mexico City. We'd go back in a heartbeat. It was an amazing trip, but we made two mistakes while we were there. First one, it's very high elevation and it was super sunny and we for some reason didn't think to bring sunscreen. So we were extremely sunburned, like really, really red. I think to the point we had some poisoning. We just felt absolutely awful, like chills, just horrible. But we could have lived with that. What happened next was probably the most rookie mistake visiting Mexico, the thing they tell you don't do. We had ice cubes. And I'm sure you can imagine what happened to us. We'll spare you the details, but we were incredibly sick. I got sick the last full day of our trip. Adam got sick that night. It was just extremely bad.
Yeah, we're gonna take a Uber, you know, it's the last day we were taking an Uber to the airport, 15-minute ride, something like that. And we were not sure if we were going to make it because it did not feel good. And then going through the security in the airport, Just rookie mistakes.
Yeah, it was brutal. We got some medicine at the airport, made it back to Seattle without having any issues. Mm-hmm. I was sick, though, for like a week, so I had to go see a doctor, and I was fine. They just gave me some medicine. We didn't mention this on the vlog, though, because back then we were pretty new to vlogging, and we just didn't want, I guess, to talk about anything negative that happened. We were just trying to be like positive all the time. Now, if that had happened, we would have said something, because we want to keep it real and be honest, but back then we didn't say anything. But I bet if you watched our third Mexico City vlog, you probably, one, you could tell our sunburn was there. And two, you might be able to see, like, my face just being, like, the whole day. What city / states would you recommend first for someone who has never visited the Pacific Northwest?
So we would definitely recommend a road trip in Oregon and up to Washington. So fly into Portland, start there, get your car, go to Cannon Beach along the coast. Absolutely gorgeous place. Then go up to the Columbia River Gorge. That place is awesome.
Gorgeous.
It's gorgeous, some might say. Cross over into Washington. Go up to Mount Rainier. You have to go there. Just amazing. Then go over up to the Olympic Peninsula. Do as much as you can there. Another amazing place. And then end up in Seattle. So you get a little bit of city life. You get some awesome food in all those places, or the cities at least. Yeah. And then just gorgeous, different, varying landscapes. You got beaches, you're gonna see snow, mountains, forests, waterfalls. You're gonna see it all. So that'd be an awesome road trip.
What is your favorite national park so far?
Glacier.
Hands down.
Glacier by far. Just amazing. I've said amazing a lot, but it is very applicable to everything I'm talking
breathtaking.
About. Breathtaking, just gorgeous.
Jaw-dropping,
some might say as well. Just all the entire time you're there, 24/7, you're going to love it there. It's just beautiful.
So when we went, the east side of the park was closed, and someone asked, what hikes do you want to do on the east side whenever you go back and it's open? So we can't speak to these personally, but the ones that have caught our eye are Iceberg Lake, Grinnell, I always say that wrong, dang it, Grinnell Glacier, Ptarmigan Lake and Tunnel Trail.
Starts with a P.
Yeah, and Cracker Lake. They all just look like really epic hikes, so we cannot wait to go back. What is the easiest national park to visit, such as with easy parking, no crowds, etc.? So one that came to mind first was Badlands. When we were there, we didn't see many people at all. There's tons of parking, and all the hikes are very short and easy, at least the popular ones. They're like a mile or 2 miles, pretty flat, so it's pretty accessible for everyone. The only downside is it's in South Dakota, not near a major city, so it's a little harder to get to.
Yeah, we also really loved and thought we had, or was easy to experience, was the Everglades. So it's close to Miami, so it's easy to get into. So you go there, it's got pretty flat trails, nothing, no big mountains to climb or anything, but it's a very unique landscape, and it's just very accessible and all kinds of wildlife.
And gators.
Yeah, and gators, tons of gators you can get close up to, maybe not this close, but
don't get that close.
I wouldn't recommend that. We also love Saguaro. It's right there in Tucson. It has a variety of different trails, the difficulty levels. You're close to the city. We didn't see a ton of people when we were there, and it's just gorgeous.
Yeah, tons of cacti, saguaros. Mm-hmm. Our biggest tip, though, regardless of what national park you visit, is just get there early. Start your day early. We try to start our days as early as possible, and even at the really busy national parks during the peak seasons, we've been able to experience a lot of solitude. So just forego a little bit of sleep, and even if you're at a popular park, you'll still get to have some peace and quiet if you just don't get up late and drink a lot of coffee. Yeah. How do you know what places you can fly your drone? So we have an app called AirMap that we use, and it basically will tell you if you can or cannot fly, if there are restrictions, if you need to get approval. So that's very helpful. We also know that you cannot fly drones in national parks ever, or at the national park managed sites, which is about like 400 or so. Mm-hmm. So a lot of places are off limits. State parks, you typically cannot fly drones, but there are some exceptions, and they don't always show up on AirMap, so we always look at the state park's website and see if you're allowed to or not, and sometimes we've had luck, but sometimes we don't.
What are the best sights to see and foods to eat in Texas? Our favorite big cities are Austin and San Antonio. San Antonio has really interesting history, culture, delicious food, really close to nature, and our favorite nature spots in Texas are Big Bend, Guadalupe Mountains National Park, and we've really been loving the Panhandle, just incredible scenery.
The Hill Country is also great. There's a lot of really cool small towns, as well as awesome state parks like Garner State Park, which we went
love
to a couple
place.
Videos ago. Amazing.
So much fun.
As for food, barbecue and tacos are definitely the thing we talk about the most in Texas, but there's so much more to try. So there's a really large German population or influence in Texas, especially in New Braunfels and Fredericksburg. So there's German restaurants, even festivals. There's also a large Czech population in this town called West that's just north of Waco. They have a ton of kolache shops, so you gotta go try those out. There's also, obviously, a big, you know, Mexican influence. There's Tex-Mex, you know, which can be more than just tacos. El Paso has amazing Mexican food because it's right on the border. And then Houston's one of the most diverse cities in the U.S., so you can find any cuisine you want there. And what we've tried there has been amazing. And then one random thing is that Texas is one of the largest growers of pecans. So pecan pie is big here, too. There's, like, this big squirrel on the side of, I think, 71, and they have a pecan pie vending machine. So we might need to go find that soon.
What are your top hiking bag essentials? So we always try to have the 10 essentials on us. Enough food if we get hungry. Water, we love our camel bag. Thing's awesome. First aid supplies if we get hurt, come across someone who's hurt. Another thing is a headlamp if we're starting really early or ending really late. We like to have hot hands if it's really cold. Those are clutch and awesome. If Kona's with us, we of course have poop bags, so make sure you
scoop your poop.
We have recently got into the All Trails Pro app. Yeah, All Trails Pro.
The pro version. Yeah.
Thought I was saying you're wrong. But we love it. It's really awesome. You can track your hike.
Download maps.
Awesome. And then another new item we got recently is a Garmin InReach Mini. It's basically a satellite communicator, so we can text loved ones when we arrive or when we finish. And there's also an SOS button if we're in trouble or we come across someone who is in trouble. It's kind of pricey, and we cover it a little bit more in our previous vlog, but we are happy with it.
Yeah, it's a good investment, especially if you have people that are worried about you when you're hiking like we do. Like my mom. I love you, Mom.
Our next set of questions is about van life, and we thought we'd move to a spot that kind of demonstrates why we love van life so much. We can live almost anywhere, and this is our backyard for the week.
Isn't this view crazy? It is so beautiful here. So the first van life question is, how long do you plan to do van life? Do you have plans to settle down? And if so, where would it be? So, I mean, we have no plans to stop van life. I mean, we can see ourselves doing this for years. There's so many places in the U.S. that we still want to explore.
Long list left.
Long list. As for, what was the second question? Do you have plans to settle down? Maybe one day?
Maybe one day, yeah.
Right now, we don't see ourselves settling down full time. We just want to keep traveling. We've talked about building a tiny house someday. That's probably still a few years away. And whenever we do settle down, it'll definitely be out west. We loved living in Seattle, but we've learned more recently we love like the small, medium-sized cities out west.
They have to start with a B, though.
Bend, Boise, Bozeman we've just loved like the size and just the vibe and everything. So who knows where it'll be, when it'll happen, but we have no plans to stop traveling full-time anytime soon.
What are your favorite apps for camping and picking routes? So when we're driving, we're always using Google Maps for GPS. Sometimes when we have a really long drive, we'll use Road Trippers to find some random stops that we could stop at just for fun. And for camping, we like to use Campendium for free campsites. We use freecampsites.net, that's a good one. And then if we're looking for like a Walmart, some kind of parking lot to sleep in, we'll use RV Parky.
It'll tell you like which parking lots allow it. You can read reviews to see if it's safe and stuff. So we use so many different apps, but those are like the three we use most of the time. Where's the best place you have camped in the van, and do you prefer boondocking or campgrounds? The first spot that comes to mind for best free campsite, especially boondocking, is the one at Badlands. It's just outside the park, but you're on the edge of the Badlands looking over. Since it's out of the park, we could fly our drone, so that was a bonus. It was just incredible.
We had an amazing experience in Southwest Colorado, also near Durango area. Just beautiful. We had cell service, plenty of land to stay on. It was just amazing mountains surrounding you. And then also by Great Sand Dunes.
Yeah,
there's a really nice spot over there next to some of the small towns. And as far as boondocking versus camping, we would definitely prefer to boondock because it's free. You can kind of find your own space.
Out in nature.
Out in nature. A lot of times you will have cell service. Sometimes you don't, and you just prepare for it. But yeah, definitely boondocking over campsites.
Yeah, campsites are great. And now that we have shore power and we're camping this week, hooked up to shore power the whole time, you have unlimited power, and it's the absolute best. Yeah. We have water. It's like every struggle we have on the road has been solved this week at the campground. Yeah. We only paid like $76 for 5 nights, but that is very, very cheap.
It's a deal.
So campgrounds are so expensive. They add up so fast. I mean, if it's $30 a night, you camp every night, that's like $900 a month. Yeah. So that's just not doable. So in the future, we're going to boondock or sleep in Walmarts as much as we can. And if we need to top up our power or just want like a relaxing experience, we'll book a campsite. They have their perks, but it's really fun to just like camp out by the mountains. Oh gosh, there's a bee on the camera. Oh no, my worst fear. I think it's actually a ladybug.
Maybe.
It's a yellow ladybug. Cool.
Oh yeah, he's like green or yellow.
That's pretty.
Do you miss having a static home with family and friends close by? We don't miss having an apartment and the bills and the rent that comes along with that. We much prefer our van. It just feels like our home. We built it exactly the way we want, and it's comfortable, and we can take it anywhere, so it's fun. And as far as the friends and family thing, a lot of our friends and family are spread out all across the nation, and to be honest, we've seen them more often since being in the van than before the van, which is kind of crazy.
Yeah, no, it's a really great added perk.
Yeah.
Have you ever booked a hotel or Airbnb because you're sick of the van? Not because we're sick of the van, but because of heat. So this summer we got stuck in a heat wave. It felt like it was following us from like Spokane through South Dakota. Brutal. And it was brutal. It was like 100 degrees during the day. So we'd have to like go park where we can have the doors open and stuff. But anyway, one night in South Dakota, it was 100 degrees and it was gonna be really hot. So we booked a hotel. We're like, let's just have a nice night in a hotel. But as soon as we booked it, this like hailstorm came through. It was crazy. It was such a huge hailstorm. We're all like hiding underneath the gas station pumps. It was kind of funny.
Worried about these big hail.
It was funny. And then the temperature cooled down like 20 to 30 degrees. So we get to the hotel and it's not even hot anymore, but we still slept there because it was AC, Wi-Fi, long showers, and just we already had paid for it.
What is one thing you would like to change about the van? So we've made a few changes already, but some things that we would like to change but probably not going to be able to is in the back, we'd like to add T-vent windows. There's just not much ventilation back there. It just gets stuffy in there on the warm days. We would like to add an AC unit. Probably not going to happen.
I don't think we'd have, yeah, that'd be
it'd,
too hard.
It'd just be a big, big project. Probably not going to happen. And then also we would love to have built in a crate for Kona inside of our closet, make it big enough, nice and spacious and comfortable for her. When we built the van, we just didn't anticipate that we would need her crate out as much as we do. So that would be nice to have that out of the way, because it's kind of a pain getting in and out of the, going from the front to the back of the van. But
we're getting used to it. And someone did ask like, where's Kona when we're driving? And she's in a crate just right behind our seat. She loves her kennel. And so she's super comfortable and safe there. All right, this is a touchy subject.
This is a divisive one.
How much do you spend a year on maintenance on your van? Too much is the answer. We love our Sprinter. If we could go back in time, we'd still pick the Sprinter. It's been very reliable. We just love the Sprinter. However, the rumors are true. It is expensive to maintain. Last year, we spent $2,000 on oil changes, fuel filter replacements, and transmission fluids.
That's like 4 services total.
You don't even get oil changes that much in the Sprinter, as much as a car, and they're very expensive. Yeah. So where this becomes a touchy subject is...
So I worry and worry and worry about it, and then I put it off and put it off and put it off, and so we're left with, we're in a random town. There's a Mercedes dealership over there. We could go there. I can't find an independent one with good reviews, something like that.
So then we go to the dealership.
Yeah.
They charge us for things we maybe didn't really need or we didn't know about, like DEF fluid one time.
Random fluids in the engine that you can add yourself.
One time we complained and they gave us a $50 voucher. Mm-hmm. And then the next time we went, we're like, let's just go. We have this voucher. They wouldn't redeem the voucher. So we were very mad. So we'll never go to the dealer again.
For service.
Yeah. Going to a Sprinter certified mechanic is so much cheaper, and you're supporting more of a local business. So I don't know. It's just better all around. Yeah. They can be harder to find, but sometimes he says he can't find one, and then I find one, and then I'm like kind of mad that we got like screwed over by the dealership.
Swindled.
So, I mean, we had a great experience buying our Mercedes at Mercedes-Benz of Georgetown. Shout out to Tim.
Yeah.
He was great. The maintenance experience there and other dealers across the U.S. has
not
been good. Just go to the Sprinter certified mechanic. For our last chunk of questions, we have a handful of this or that type questions that we're going to turn into a lightning round.
Lightning round.
And because the video is probably already super long, we're gonna give ourselves 90 seconds to answer as many as we can, as fast as we can.
All right, ready, set, go. Beach or mountains?
Mountains.
Mountains. I don't know how this is. Okay, van that can drive underwater or van that can fly? Fly.
Fly.
Grand Teton or Yellowstone?
Teton.
Yellowstone. Summer or winter?
Summer.
Summer. Italian pizza or Italian pasta? Pizza.
Pasta.
Theme park or water park? Theme park. Theme park. Cruise in Antarctica or the Galapagos?
Galapagos.
Antarctica.
Galapagos.
Antarctica. Lions on land or sea lions? Sea lions.
Lions on land.
Bungee jumping or skydiving?
Skydiving.
Skydiving. Fall or spring?
Oh no, this is an hour and a half.
Oh no! We'll put a timer on the screen. Spin, okay, yeah. Fall or spring?
Fall.
Fall. Travel through time or travel through space?
This is so hard.
Travel through time. For me. Time.
But it's so hard because you're going through space, but you're kind of going through time. What? Where am I?
Oh, deep stuff. Kayaking or sup?
Kayaking.
We have a kayak now. Yeah. Woo! Would you rather be a horse or a duck for a day? A horse.
A horse.
Because I can get around faster. Have an airline cancel on you last minute or have an accommodation cancel on you last minute?
Accommodation.
Airline, for sure. Because then you wouldn't be homeless for the night. You just have to find another way to
but
get there.
But you could just get a new accommodation, whereas you can't even get there if you have your airline canceled.
Hopefully neither happened. All right, last one, and it's hard. Ice cream or tacos? Tacos.
I'm gonna go with tacos.
Usually, like, ice cream, I never feel that great after I eat it because it's really sugary. I love it, but I don't feel great.
I can eat more tacos.
I've never once felt bad after eating tacos. Okay, so we accidentally did an hour and a half.
The minute 50, right?
Oh, no.
We went 20 over.
Really? I thought we were going
bonus.
So fast. Bonus content. Whoops.
That was fun, though.
That was fun. Thank you, Caroline, for sending us a bunch of those
awesome
questions. A huge thank you to everyone who submitted questions. We had so much fun answering them.
A lot
we
of
hope
fun.
You guys enjoyed listening to our answers. We tried to answer as many as we could, but we unfortunately could not get to all of them. So if we did not answer your question or you have a new question, please send us an Instagram message, email, or you can just comment below and we're happy to answer it.
So we're gonna spend the rest of the week here at the campsite before we head to Palo Duro Canyon State Park this weekend. We've been there before, we absolutely love it, and we cannot wait to make it back there.